for the Hawaiian Nation are to determine our future. Lei Anuenue's tall claim to be the representative voice.
And I said, I won't work for this Papakōlea because wherever I went, I've always said I'm from Papakōlea. You know, you get it bombarded all one time.
Yeah.
You know, but little by little, getting my little.
Thank you for sharing. That's why we got that. We're going to compile that. So at least the submitter, we know that you submitted the names of others. We don't mind taking the names of the other people in it, but we know that they're going to know that they were on top of the ribbon.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Don't touch.
That's this one, your motto.
Oh my God.
How's retirement treating you? Sorry.
No, I need you in
I
the
I love room. It, but I'm busy.
I gotta go look at the mirror eye upstairs. Okay, I'll go look. No, enough of that.
Get him.
Oh, thank you.
All right.
Right, good. That's a fine ball mix.
This is our commercial kitchen here in Papakōlea, available to all the Hawaiians across the island of Oahu. If you guys get kaukau, you package, you need certified kitchen, we get Department of Health permit, wow. Certified kitchen. Wow. This was built to help the Hawaiians. So all the Hawaiians, you come, Hele Mai, our executive director upstairs is Lilia Kapuniai. You can reach her at 520-8998. And all the Hawaiians, welcome, no matter where you're from on the islands. Welcome, our commercial kitchen. All right.
The biggest stew I've ever seen.
And you know what? That's the baby pot, that one. You should see the big one.
Oh,
yeah. Forget that. Oh, Ikalamai. So sorry. Or, no. Ikalamai.
Hello.
See you. All right, yeah. Papakōlea. And see this beautiful beef stew. All right.
One side down.
One more. Yeah, I can. Mahalo for the stew.
Oh, you're welcome. Thank you for having me.
No, thank you for hosting all the people around the island. You know,
I got plenty, but I feel like a couple of bagels coming up. Thank you so much for having me. Thank you.
Hi, Oren.
Hi.
Aloha.
So this is the sign-in area.
Well, this is not signing in, but yeah.
Sign-in. No.
The sign-in area.
I like that. So that's a declaration.
Yes, the declaration. Declaration reaffirming independence and protesting Kanaʻioluwalu and United States federal recognition.
Declaration of Lāhui Kanaka.
And the declaration of the Lāhui Kanaka is on the flip side.
Here. And we have the gated 80.
And we have the Kanaʻioluwalu gated 88 constitution. Why it's a Pono'ole process.
That's the US, I call it the USA Ha. The breath of the Ha, you know, USA.
Which is Ha'ole, no breath.
Ha'ole.
But, so a few people signed in today?
Yes, we filled quite a few sheets of sign-in participants that have come to share and learn and be AI educated.
Yeah. So this is a kuʻe petition table.
This is a kuʻe petition where you find your family, your ohana, that signed the kuʻe petition protesting annexation in 1898. So your kupuna's in here, and when you find their names, there's several ramifications to that. One, it shows who were the subjects of the kingdom and loyal to the queen. Secondly, it shows, if you can find your kupuna in here, it shows that you are still a lineal descendant and a subject of the kingdom. The significance of that is in the Hawaiian Constitution, only the subjects of the kingdom can own land. So you might be heir to land, but you can't take possession of it if you're an American. You have to be a subject of the kingdom. The other part to that is you can't have dual citizenship as a subject of the kingdom. So that's a whole nother chapter, but for here and now, you just need to find your kupuna. And these binders, we have a database by alphabetical order, and then it aligns with the pages and the line numbers, so you can actually see the signatures of your kupuna at that when they signed at that time. So I invite you all to find your kupuna.
Thanks, we'll come back.
Okay, aloha. And this is one of the ways. This is probably the easiest way. You found your family? And then you can turn to that page and take a picture of their actual signatures, which is pretty special.
And then if you sign this, you become the living voice.
All your rights are preserved because they didn't have the right in international law to take them away from you.
Aloha, I'm Filippo Souza, Hawaiian National. As you can see, the coalition of Hawaiian Nationals. We're here at Papakōlea, participating in these aha, an interesting presentation, putting together some thoughts of the people, and basically laying low what the pu'uwai of the people is saying, yeah, and not necessarily what is being promoted in the so-called media. And there's been a lot of good thoughts and a direction that we need to go. And that direction is very similar to what the Kuʻe petition was in 1897. Although it addressed only one thing, annexation. Today we have a situation that we have 10,000 items that are affecting the people of today, of Hawaii. Not only the Kanaka Maoli, but all Hawaiian nationals also. And it's a good thing. As you can see, the sign says, Free Hawaii. No ke koho, the choice is yours. And that's what we present to the people. We all cannot be the Kanaka Maoli, but we all are Hawaiian nationals by birth. Thank you very much.
Okay, everybody, we're going to start up again. So you guys on the top. Woo! My. We're going to start up again. Mahalo.
If we can start to come back into the area, we're going to get started again for our second half, our presentations and our group. So we're going to go over a few things regarding our declaration. We're going to have a presentation. So the first person that I want to introduce again, truly an inspiration, because these Aha Aloha Aina that we're having here in Papakōlea has happened all across the Paiaina. And Kalama has been monumental in ensuring that the grassroots organization and the voice of the community is heard. So I want to bring Kalama back up here. She's going to read our Papakōlea Declaration as well as our Declaration of Affirmation.
Aloha. So those of you who went to eat some wonderful mea'ai, what did you guys think about the mea'ai of Papakōlea? Let's get a hula for the chefs of Papakōlea. Hula! Because it is the leaders of the community, we're always by tradition the ones who fed the community. And if you don't feed the people, how can you lead the people? So ikomo mai again, I'd like to bring back, for those of you who did not hear or were present for the summation of the introduction of the Papakōlea Declaration of 2016. So you heard the kino. What's the intro? So with Auntie Midge's help, Kokua, she told us, gave us a beautiful history of Papakōlea, and you can read through that over in the corner. The history of Papakōlea is rich, just as the community is rich in the vaivai of the aina, the wealth of the aina. One, whereas the overthrow of 1893 marginalized thousands of Kanaka Maoli and kingdom citizens. In spite of this, we continued to understand that all lands were the king's. And that's a quote from the history, from Papakōlea's history. Two, whereas in 1901, the first Ohana put their hands and invested their mo'okuauhau, or genealogy, in the soil of Papakōlea. Whereas by 1920, 28 families were residing in our community. And when I say our, it's because it's coming from Auntie Midge's Manao, coming from the Papakōlea community. The only reason why I'm reading it myself is because she asked me to, and hard to read my writing, yeah? Kalamaya Makauka. Whereas in 1934, Papakōlea was amended into the Hawaiian Homestead Act. So Papakōlea community predates the Hawaiian Homestead Act. They just kind of try to appropriate you guys' mana, but. So whereas Papakōlea has historically and continually determined the needs and leadership of our community, whereas the Papakōlea community welcomed our people, the kino of our people, on April 30th, 2016, via this Aha Aloha Āina. Whereas we reassert that Nāʻiaupuni is not the sole voice of Nā Kanaka Maoli. Eo, Papakōlea! So, from a showing of hula, how many here agree to this introduction, the Papakōlea Declaration of 2016? Hula! Oh, come on, you guys. That was kind of sad. I know you guys ate, and the food was really good. Let's put a little bit more mana behind that. Hula means hooray. Yeah, right on. So, who here stands behind the declaration of the Papakōlea 2016? Hula! My kai, that's more like it. And so what we're going to do is we're going to put it together, we're going to type it up, we're going to pass it back to the Papakōlea Community Association, and we'll have make sure that, you know, the manawa was right, we're going to put the kahakos, the alkinas in the right kind of place. I'm going to need some help with that, I'm not so great with that. So, but we're going to put that back, and we're going to give it back to the community, and then they will release it along with your signatures. So again, please, before you leave, if you would like to sign and you're a part of creating this declaration, we want to honor the Papakōlea community first. We want to identify the Papa. This is your aina, and we are guests. So if you agree as Papakōlea community, please sign here. And all of the rest, the Lāhui kākoʻo, those who came to support you, you can sign down below. This is part of a larger effort. The Aha Aloha Āina has put together two declarations that you can be a part of. First, there's one very specific. And this paper, palapala, that you've been passed out today, and if you lost yours or haven't gotten one yet, you can go to the front and you can read the two declarations. The first one is a declaration from Lāhui Kanaka rejecting and condemning Naʻiapuni Aha. And I'll read it for you. Because before you leave today, I would like those of you who stand behind these declarations, you can sign both. You can sign one or you can sign both to sign and to join up with the larger Aha Aloha Āina declarations. And first, so the first one is a declaration condemning Naʻiapuni Aha. We, the undersigned, firmly reject the illegitimate Naʻiapuni Aha objective to create a native Hawaiian government. We stand in opposition to any government documents and governing body that is produced through this Aha. We continue to stand for the unification of our people through a transparent process, free from any state or federal interference, control, our prescribed destiny. The Aha 2016 stems from a top-down approach in which all of the terms, the use of Hawaiian trust monies, participation, timeline, representation, the convention, and outcomes have been determined by a small number of people, including former Governor Abercrombie, the state legislature, the governor-appointed Kanaʻioluwalu commissioners, the OHA Board of Trustees, the OHA-selected Naʻiapuni Board, and approximately 150 self-appointed AHA participants. Each of these parties is complicit in driving an agenda that has divided our people more than ever. In addition to this deeply flawed process, the 150 individuals who have not been elected or vetted have nevertheless decided to produce governing documents that will attempt to create a governing body on behalf of the Hawaiian nation in a private meeting. This approach violates the basic principles of self-determination, upholds the status quo, and must be rejected. The undersigned demand that the AHA 2016 cease and desist from continuing to produce and propagate any governing documents. We stand in opposition to any attempts by individuals or organizations selected and sponsored by the state of Hawaii to speak for the Hawaiian nation or to determine our future. We support an open and transparent process that is based on education, consultation, consent, and unity. We call upon the AHA participants to join us in demanding nothing less than an initiative envisioned and designed by our Lāhui, open to all Kanaka who wish to participate, free from conditions that we had no part in creating. Such a process should include an appropriate time frame for such an important task. It should be open, and it should be free of any state of Hawaii interference, control, or prescribed destiny. If you'd like to sign this declaration, what you can do is you go to, who has your phones? Anybody have a smartphone that they can open, take a look at? So if you go to your smartphone, you can go click on the internet and the website, type in ahaalohaaina.com, no spaces, and there's a section that says the petitions. So you can go straight there, and that's the first petition. This is the second one, and this is for the guys with a little bit more ni'oi, ready to go on to straight up reaffirming independence. Oh, yeah. So, whereas Kanaka Maoli are the first peoples of Ko, Hawaii, Pai, Aina, the Hawaiian archipelago, since time immemorial, whereas the Kingdom of Hawaii was recognized as a nation in 1843 by the then Family of Nations, whereas the multi-ethnic Kingdom of Hawaii, the majority of which were Kanaka Maoli, was overthrown in 1893 by a small clique of American businessmen with the assistance of the United States military. where is the living descendants of the citizens of the Kingdom of Hawaii, like their ancestors, continue to assert unrelinquished sovereignty over Ko Hawaii Pai Aina. Whereas in 2014, the Department of Interior ignored all verbal testimony for restitution, reconciliation, self-determination, and independence, as they, the DOI, continues to pursue the path of federal recognition for Hawaii. Therefore, be it resolved that we reaffirm our right to independence and self-determination, repudiate, and that's like reject, Naiopuni's false claim to be the representative voice of the Kanaka Maoli people. Reject the present and future, because remember, Akaka Bill started 2000, yeah? Keeps on coming back over and over again like a bad penny. U.S. attempts through the DOI to federally recognize the Kanaka Maoli people on a par with a Native American tribe under the document entitled Procedures for Reestablishing a Formal Government-to-Government Relationship with a Native Hawaiian Community. We assert our commitment to uphold and honor the ongoing endeavors to rebuild and strengthen our Lāhui via, among other ways, the reclamation of our gathering rights, the spread of Ōlelo and the re-envisioning of our educational systems, the revitalization of our traditional resources, stewardship that assured food sustainability through responsible stream, estuary, reef management, as well as kalo farming and fish pond upkeep. Resistance to the perils of climate change via the pursuit of a truly independent economic system free from the stranglehold of transnational corporations. The invigoration of traditional means of healing such as aipono, ho'oponopono, lomi lomi, and the protection of wahipana like Mauna Kea, Waipio, and Haleakala. And six, the expansion of scholarly research to uncover the full range of traditional knowledge that our kupuna gifted us. Finally, we shall unify all efforts to create an independent Hawaii and so restore Ko Hawaii Pai Aina to the descendants of the Hawaiian Kingdom for a better future for generations to come. Eo. Mahalo nui.
Let's give another hand for our declaration reaffirming our independence. We know what we don't want. We don't want Naiopuni. Those going there, they don't represent us. But we should also be steadfast in knowing what we do want. And I love this declaration reaffirming our independence. The next person that I would like to introduce, knowing what we want, we need to get a good context of our history, of the history of the opposition, not the opposition, but the history of kind of the corrupt process of this Naiopuni. And so one of a great friend, a good mentor, and one damn hammer, Aloha Āina, Andre Perez. Well, Andre is going to give us a presentation on the history, Andre.
Aloha Āina kākou, aloha. Kalama, normally I give this as a presentation, a PowerPoint presentation. And so, because we didn't have a projector, I'm going to just kind of talk off of my laptop PowerPoint. So what I try to do is just tell a certain mo'olelo, yeah, a certain story. And this is only part of the story. It's not the whole story. It's just little, actually, this is kind of my story in a sense. It's the journey that I've been on as an activist resisting federal recognition. And so these are all kind of my memories, I guess, in a sense, and personal experiences. But it tells an important part of the story of how we came to be where we are today with Department of Interior offering some type of recognition, and of course now this $3 million $3 million process called Kanaʻioluwalu. Yeah? So I think an important thing to kind of, important place to start is 1993 with and the Apology Bill. Because it's the Apology Bill that sets the tone, and it's the Apology Bill that sort of initiates this sequence of events that leads us where we are today. So most of us are familiar with the Apology Bill, right? 1993, President Clinton signs the bill, Public Law 103-150, acknowledging the United States' role in the overthrow. And a couple of key things in there, I think. The Apology Bill affirms that Hawaiians never directly relinquished their claims to their inherent sovereignty as a people or over their national lands. And that's kind of important. We really want to pay attention to the language. So the Apology Bill says that we never relinquished our claims to our inherent sovereignty. So what is inherent sovereignty? I mean, either you're sovereign or you're not. Sovereignty or no more sovereignty. How come we get this word inherent in front? So, you know, this is, I mean, I don't know, 10 years ago I started researching. And if you have a smartphone, you can take out your phone right now and Google inherent sovereignty. And the first thing that's going to come up at the top of the list is tribal sovereignty. Yeah? In relationship to Native American federal recognition within the U.S. framework, yeah? So this is important because back in 1993, they already were kind of setting the parameters of what reconciliation was going to look like for us. And of course, that's one of the key things of the Apology Bill, is that it calls for reconciliation between the United States and the Native Hawaiian people. Interesting enough, too, the Apology Bill never mentions the Hawaiian kingdom, the government or the kingdom. It only mentions Hawaiian people, yeah, and really talking about us today. So it calls for reconciliation, and it says that we never acquiesced our claims over our inherent sovereignty. So because of this call for reconciliation in the late 90s, I believe, maybe 90, I want to say 97, 98, they have this joint task force, and they come and they introduce Akaka Bill, yeah? And the Akaka Bill is offered up to Hawaii, to Hawaiians, to Kanaka. And the Akaka Bill seeks federal recognition from Congress. And it was supposed to have these island-wide hearings, just like the Department of Interior hearings. That's the only way that they can really have complete their due diligence, yeah? They gotta have consultation. So what happened with the Akaka Bill in August of 2000 here in Honolulu was they have the first Akaka Bill hearing. And the response at that one hearing, the hearing was 3 days long, and the people were overwhelmingly against the Akaka Bill. And if you look, there's a video actually up on YouTube. You can look at the video, and I only remember two people who vote in support. One was Daviana McGregor, who has always been for federal recognition. She's a professor of ethnic studies. She's one of the current organizers for the Protect Kaho'olawe Ohana. And the other one was Don Ho. So other than that, all the other couple hundred Hawaiians who were there were absolutely against Akaka Bill. And at that time, it was real easy to understand why we were against the Akaka Bill. All you had to do was read it. Yeah, and in 2000, the Akaka Bill told us that we were Native Americans, indigenous to the United States, subject to the Constitution. So that was the first paragraph. So if we cannot even get past the first paragraph, we had problems. The Akaka Bill never offered us any land, never offered us any water rights, never even offered us any money. It didn't offer us nothing. But it told us that we couldn't do, yeah? We couldn't interfere with military operations. We couldn't have casinos the way other Native Americans have. And this sort of like laundry list of all the things we couldn't have. So Akaka Bill really was just kind of a bad deal. And then they kept having different versions going from 2000 all the way till 2012, I believe. 12 years of these versions that got progressively worse and worse. So Akaka Bill was the first one. Everybody rejects it. 3 days, three days of hearings on Oahu. Overwhelmingly opposition. After that, they subsequently cancel all other hearings. Imagine that. All the other island hearings were all canceled. Boom. There was this excuse, Akaka is sick. So we can have hearings. So all of you remember the Akaka Bill, right? So they had 12 years of trying to pass the Akaka Bill with no hearings. Yeah? But they did. They tried to pass it to the point where the Akaka Bill ends up on the floor of the U.S. Congress, yeah? Where they're trying to have this, they're trying to kind of slide it in through a side door using this special vote called a cloture vote. And what was interesting is during, and I believe that was 2006 maybe, six or seven. So Senator Akaka is on the floor of the Congress. They're trying to force this cloture vote, which would kind of circumvent the obstacles of getting a majority from the House and Senate and trying to get the Akaka Bill passed. And one of the other senators asked Akaka, well, what if Hawaiians want independence? And Senator Akaka, I don't know what he was thinking, but I was happy. His response was, if my Hawaiian people want independence, they should have it. And he immediately lost all the support of the support that he did have for at that moment in the Congress was gone. So he effectively killed the Akaka Bill right there. And so Akaka Bill went on and on and on for about a dozen years. And we fought it and fought it and we organized. We organized a really effective group called Huipu. It was a collective of sovereignty and community activists and organizers. And we got together and for about 7 or 8 years just actively organized against Akaka Bill. So eventually Akaka Bill dies. And if I remember correctly, the way that it really kind of died was Robin Danner had gone up to D.C. on her own and had made some changes to the language in that latest version of Akaka Bill. And if I remember correctly, what the language was that if federal recognition was to pass, then the entity that would be the Hawaiian nation would have immediate governing powers. And she did it very unilaterally. So at that time, Akaka Bill supporters also had the support of Linda Lingo, of Neil Abercrombie, of Senator Inouye, of course, of the State Attorney General Mark Bennett. So when Robin did this, she went up by herself, never tell nobody, and then all of a sudden, a new legislative season comes up and there's this new Akaka Bill that's got this different language. And so Linda Lingo was caught off guard. State Attorney General Mark Bennett was caught off guard and Abercrombie was caught off guard. And they immediately withdrew their support. And I sat in a meeting, a personal meeting face to face with Neil Abercrombie as he was briefing the Native Hawaiian Bar Association. And he talked about it. He said, I had no idea that this happened. I was caught off guard just as much as you guys. But for us, we was happy because the zealousness, yeah, that it's just that they're so zealous about wanting federal recognition that they just go and misrepresent us, and it kind of backfired and blew up in their face. And Akaka Bill was pretty much dead after that. So after Akaka Bill dies, we basically kind of in limbo, nothing going on. And then one day, we hear about this bill that comes down. And I got to kind of point this out. Like, we were tracking, like, this stuff. Federal recognition, nation-building efforts. Like, we were on it. Like, we were in the loop, man. And then one day, this bill comes down, Act 195, that creates Kanaʻioluwalu. And nobody knew anything about Act 195. Like, well, you know, like, we didn't have a say. Why is there even an Act 195? Who created that Act 195? Was it on behalf of who? So Act 195 comes down, creates Kanaʻioluwalu as a roll commission. And then the governor, Abercrombie, appoints these commissioners, yeah? And these commissioners are kind of self-appointed, and the governor confirms them. So most of us know the Kanaʻioluwalu commissioners was Mahialani Went, Naʻalehu Anthony, John Waihe'e, former governor, Lei Kihoi, who's that? Oh, Robin Danner. there she is again. So these Kanaʻioluwalu commissioners, their job is to sign up Hawaiians to create a role, yeah? And so we were like really disturbed by this because it's not just, this is not like Kauinoa. Kauinoa was just a list, yeah? Sort of this ambiguous, undesignated list of names. But a role is something very different, yeah? A role has certain political connotations, yeah, implications. So when they use the term role, it's a list of names of verified natives, yeah? Verified, certified, show your birth certificate, whatever. But the role comes out of a long American history, yeah, of Native American recognition for tribes. And it's born out of this, the original act was called the Dawes Act. And we studied the history of the roles. In many ways, it disenfranchised Native Americans because when the role was created, this list of certified natives, they close it. The door closes at a certain time. And when that door closed, you couldn't get back in. You couldn't be in the tribe. Yeah? So you got some family members who are in the tribe and some family members who are not in the tribe. One of the interesting things, the history of the role, a little story that I heard, was when they first opened up the role for Native Americans to sign up. You know, of course, a bunch of them signed up. But there was some, I heard stories about some Native American individuals who were out hunting, like extended hunts, yeah, out in the hills, maybe for like 4 weeks, 5 weeks. And they, by the time they got back, the role had closed. So they couldn't get on. And they were forever locked out of the role, yeah? So for us, we was like, why, if this is about our self-determination and our nation, who's making a decision to create this tribal role? Because we never, anybody was part of the discussion for create one role? Raise your hand. Anybody? So who decided to create a role, yeah? A Native Hawaiian role that either you in or you out. So that was Act 195. And if you read one of the first paragraphs of Act 195, it says, the purpose of this act is to recognize Native Hawaiians as the only indigenous Aboriginal Maoli population of Hawaii. It's also the state's desire to support the continuing development of a reorganized Native Hawaiian governing entity, and ultimately the federal recognition of Native Hawaiians. So right there, it says it in Act 195, the objective is to create a federally recognized entity. And of course it says the development of a reorganized. So they're taking something that was organized, yeah, and they're going to reorganize them. Of course that something was the Kingdom of Hawaii, right? And now they want to reorganize us into a federally recognized tribe. So that's what Act 195 does, and it's really important to pay attention to the language in Act 195 because Act 195 already offers, yeah? The purpose of this act is to recognize Native Hawaiians. So the recognition is there. State recognition exists. And that's we're gonna see how that can play out in the future. So again, Abercrombie appoints these commissioners. Anybody would nominate Waihe'e or Robin Danner or Lei Kihoi or Naʻalehu Anthony. Raise your hand. You guys would nominate them. So these guys are commissioners building the roll that's going to be used for federal recognition. So the reason I'm pointing this out is all of this, this whole history is based on the idea of self-determination for Hawaiians, right? Our self-determination, yeah. But yet, when you look at the story as it unfolds, we find out that we actually have very little to none, to no self-determination. All of these decisions are made for us. People are selected, not elected, and so forth. So most of us know, I think, Kanaʻioluwalu, the role, the native certified native role, was a total utter failure. Yeah. So they give over, I think a grand total was close to like $5 million. Office of Hawaiian Affairs gives $5 million for the Kanaʻioluwalu commissioners to make this list of natives. And it was the actual sign up, people signing up was very, very poor. It was a total failure. So I think like after the first year, they had like only like 9,000 names, and then it went to 15,000, and they were literally putting millions. Another interesting thing is, I've heard at least on a couple of occasions, the CEO of Office of Hawaiian Affairs, Kamanaʻopono Crab, has stated publicly in public forums that Act 195 made OHA pay for Kanaʻioluwalu. So even OHA was kind of like forced into something, yeah? So OHA had to fork over all this money to pay for the role. And what we hear now is there was no accountability. There was no reporting back on how they were using the money. It was like, here's the money, in essence, do what you like, and there's no accountability. So the role is not working. People are not signing up. And then we see this ad in Kawaiʻola, OHA newspaper, yeah? Somebody runs this ad. Well, we gotta give OHA the kai, and they control the newspaper, right? The buck stops with them. They are the editors and the printers. So in the Kawaiʻola newspaper is this ad, notice. It's a notice. And it says, it's about the Kanaʻioluwalu roll. And the notice says, Native Hawaiians who choose not to be included on the official roll risk waiving their right and the right of their children and descendants to be legally and politically acknowledged as Native Hawaiians and to participate in a future convention to reorganize, there's that word again, to reorganize the Hawaiian nation. And as a result, may be excluded from being granted rights of inclusion, citizenship, right of participation in voting, and rights to potential benefits that may come with citizenship. So what they're saying is to all of you, to all of us, to the entire Lāhui, if you don't sign up on this roll, you, not only you, but your descendants will not be recognized as citizens, will not be recognized as Native Hawaiians, and will not benefit from the nation. That sound like aloha to you? I mean, is that how we treat our ohana? So it's really shameful and an embarrassment that this ad came out in the newspaper. And it was a PR disaster. I thought to myself, who's doing their PR over there? Cheech or Chong? I don't know. But it was a disaster. So in essence, they try to coerce and threaten us to sign up on the roll based on fear of exclusion. So this is the history now. This is the story, yeah? This is the story behind where we at today. And again, all of this is based upon the idea of self-determination for us to figure out how we're going to recreate or achieve some kind of reconciliation and justice, or whatever you want to call it, resulting from the overthrow. So Kanaʻioluwalu catches us off guard. We don't know who the hell, where the thing came from or what, you know. Well, now we do, but at the time we never. We know that we didn't have a say in it. And then roughly a year later, in March 2014, Office of Hawaiian Affairs has this big press release. And I remember looking on the TV, and I look at the people in the in front of the OHA building at this press release. OHA announces the new nation building plan. But all the people that I see in the over there wasn't any of the people who were involved in nation building or sovereignty or independence or even I would say even the Fed Rec guys. It was like all these like mostly like cultural people, kumuhulas and stuff. And then we find out later that it was like this special invite only. OHA invites a select group of like kumuhula community leaders to this press conference to make it look like it's got support of cultural leaders, yeah? So OHA's nation building plan is called Ho'oulu Lāhui. We find out later that the plan, this is the nation building plan now, yeah? This is the map, how we're gonna get from here to here, is designed by this OHA ad hoc committee. Yeah, OHA ad hoc committee. So I start to inquire and find out that it was like five people. It was like a couple trustees and some OHA employees. So they're designing the plan, not us. No input from us, yeah? They're gonna create the map on how we're gonna go, where we're gonna go, you know? So again, we find another issue where, is this really self-determination when they doing all the designing, they doing all the planning, and we're just kind of going to participate when we get asked to participate, yeah? So, OHA makes this commitment at the same time they announce their nation-building plan that they are going to be, like, hands-off, that they're just going to facilitate, yeah? This time, they're not gonna do it like Akaka Bill. We're going to facilitate. The Hawaiian people will decide. But you see, our decision was already taken away from us before, right? When they created a role and when they created this plan to build a nation. So anyways, the interesting thing, I remember this, let's see. When OHA announced their nation building plan, I believe it was on a Friday. And then by the following Wednesday, so what is that? Friday, Saturday, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. 5 days. So after announcing that they're going to be hands-off and they're only going to facilitate, 5 days later, we find out that OHA and some of the Kanaʻioluwalu commissioners and some of their political lobbyists are in Washington, D.C. 5 days later, now, not even 1 week. So they go to the Department of Interior and they start lobbying for federal recognition. How are you going to recognize it? What do you have? You know, what's the plan? And this is coming off of their commitment, and it's a document called the Statement of Commitment. This is coming off of that written commitment that we're only going to be hands off. So OHA goes to D.C. within 5 days, and you know how we find out? Because they go to visit Maisie Hirono. Is it Hirono? Yeah. They go to visit Hirono, Talk Story, in D.C., and they take a group picture, and Maisie's aide puts it on Twitter. So we see Twitter, you know, social media. We see a picture of, hey, what the hell are these guys doing in D.C.? And I look at that picture now, and I see Kavika Riley, who's their, like, chief operations officer or something. What is he now? Huh? Chief advocate. Well, he's up there. And then I see John Wahe'e, who's a Kanaʻioluwalu commissioner. I see Judge Klein, who's OHA's highly paid legal advisor. We see John Wahe'e Jr., who's a trustee. Colette Machado, who's a trustee. And this lady, this Chinese lady, Norma Wong. That's interesting. So you look at the faces in there and you wonder, okay, why are OHA trustees in D.C. when they say that they're only going to facilitate? And then you kind of wonder, why is Kanaʻioluwalu in Washington, D.C.? If their job is to build a role, that's what Act 195 says. Their job is to sign you up on this role. That's all, nothing else. So they're not only signing people up, but they're going to D.C. and trying to lobby and trying to meddle and interfere with the political outcome. This is the evidence right here. Norma Wong, here's an interesting bit of truth, factual. This lady, Norma Wong, is a political strategist. She used to be on Waihe'e's, she was one of Waihe'e's key aides during his governorship. Norma Wong is a very savvy, politically savvy person, lady. The Kaho'olawe cleanup, I think was, what was it, $500 million for Kaho'olawe. She's the one that brokered the deal. She was kind of the mastermind for the Kaho'olawe cleanup. So Kanaʻioluwalu hires this lady, Norma Wong, as a strategic political strategist to the for a contract of $500,000. So again, if Kanaʻioluwalu's job is to create a role, which is a list of names, why do they need to hire a strategic a political strategist? Yeah, and what kind of money is that? $500,000 of OHA trust monies for this lady. She must be laughing all the way to the bank. So, okay, so that's the OHA, that's how OHA rolls out the nation building plan. But remember now, nobody's signing up for Kanaʻioluwalu. So they're no more one, citizen base. They need the names, right? They need the list of names. So shortly after comes another piece of legislation. Where this one came from? Whose idea was this? We don't know. Act 77. So Act 77 comes out again for like the umpteenth time. We caught off guard. We caught by surprise. Because of the lack of response from the Hawaiian community to signing up for Kanaʻioluwalu, Act 77 is created to allow the legal transfer of names from the Kawinoa T-shirt database, and that was like over 100,000 names. Everybody liked free T-shirt, huh? So they had 100,000 names. They grab them, drop them into Kanaʻioluwalu. The OHA Hawaiian Registry, which is really just an ancestry registry, oftentimes used for like students to get Hawaiian scholarships. They take the OHA Registry, all those names, drop them in Kanaʻioluwalu. And then Operation Ohana, you guys remember that? I think it was a genealogy program. Operation Ohana, they take all the names and they drop them into Kanaʻioluwalu. So one of the key things, one of the fundamentals of self-determination is this term that comes out of the United Nations Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous People. And it's really simple. It's not complex. But it's this term called free, prior, informed consent. In other words, I'm not supposed to do nothing that's going to affect you without your free, prior, informed consent. It's pretty simple, yeah? I cannot do nothing without your permission. So if I take all your names and I drop them into a native tribal role without your knowledge, does that sound like free, prior, informed consent to you? Absolutely not. So you see, we have these kind of compounded layers, to me at least, of violations of just basic principled behavior, basic principles of self-determination, basic morals and ethics. The kind of like, my mama when raised me like not to do things, to know like what is pono and what is not pono, yeah? And if I was sitting around the table with Kanaʻioluwalu and we were discussing, oh, we go grab all these guys' names and put them over here. I mean, for me, I mean, I would think that somebody would say, how can we do that without their consent, without their permission, yeah? Apparently, nobody said that because they did it, right? So they Act 77, they dump all these names in Kanaʻioluwalu. All of a sudden, now Kanaʻioluwalu, the role is like 130,000 names, you know, puka 100,000. So now it looks like the Kanakas are signing up, like they have something. But those of us who know this story, we know that it's a sham, it's an illusion, it's a deceit, yeah? Well, that's Act 77. Okay, so after Act 77, how much time I get? Still going. 10 minutes, okay, I can do this. So after Act 77, Office of Hawaiian Affairs comes up with this plan. And I'm not making any of this up. Even Office of Hawaiian Affairs people know that this is true. And you know, a lot of the information that I have, okay, A lot of this information is my own personal experience, and some of the backstory details were told to me by some of disgruntled Office of Hawaiian Affairs employees. So Nā'iaʻopuni originally was called the consortium. What was consortium? You know, consortium is just a whole conglomerate of something. So it starts off with the consortium, and it's supposed to be all the native, all the Hawaiian trusts, like Lunalilo Homes, I would imagine KS, the Royal Societies, like the Royal Order, the Kaʻahumanu Society, Kamamakakawa, who are descendants of warriors. A lot of these royal societies come from the kingdom, yeah? These kingdom, they're over 100 years old, these royal societies. So they get this whole group of, you know, the Royal Order, Kaʻahumanu Gang, and the trust, the Lunalilo Trust, and they're hoping that they're gonna ask them to oversee the nation building plan, the elections, and the constitution making, and the ratification. And pretty much from the get-go, the royal societies don't want to touch it. So one of the first ones is the Royal Order of Kamehameha. They basically said, we're for independence. We are for the restoration of the kingdom. So we cannot support this. So boom, they're out. Kaʻahumanu Society, my understanding is that offering them the money and control of the nation-building program caused so much internal fighting amongst the kupuna, that they kind of had a breakdown, and vice president and president kind of stepped down and stuff. So basically, this consortium idea is a total failure. It doesn't work. Nobody wants to get involved in this. And those who do kind of start fighting amongst themselves. So the consortium is out. But then out of this consortium, in terms of the organizations, the agencies, certain individuals step forward, yeah? So, and these are the ones, so OHA basically names them Nā'iaʻopuni, and they're gonna be the ones as individuals, not organizations. So Kuhio Sam from Lunalilo Homes. That's the only guy I know. I don't even know the other ones. Pauline Namuʻo, yeah, from Kaʻahumanu Society. And then the rest, like, you know, I mean, I never heard of them in the community before. So these five individuals emerge as Nā'iaʻopuni, and they go and oversee the nation building. They go and kind of put the election plan together. But we were at OHA when they were about to vote to fund Nā'iaʻopuni. Yeah? They was going to give them $3 million. So I always tell this story, and I don't like to tell this story, but it's true. Because of this incident, like, I had good friends at OHA who don't talk to me now. I got Oki Andre for being honest and for asking the principled questions. So I go before the OHA trustee board and I ask the question, okay, so you guys gonna give this guy's Nā'iaʻopuni $3 million. Who is Nā'iaʻopuni? Can you name him? Can you tell us the names of these people that you're going to give $3 million of OHA Hawaiian trust monies to? And so the trustees look at me kind of blank, you know, quiet. They don't say nothing. And then the CEO leans forward and tries to answer, and he can name two of them. And then he goes, I don't know. You know, I cannot remember the names. So, you know, it begs the question. So, okay. So you're going to give $3 million to five people you cannot even name. Does that sound like responsible money management to you? And this is Hawaiian trust funds now, right? This is not their money. It's our money. They manage the money on behalf of all of us, right? So I never in my life have I seen something like this. It's like pupule, crazy. So they hand over $3 million to Nā'iaʻopuni. Nā'iaʻopuni basically facilitates the nation plan. And in closing, I want to say more layers. So they were supposed to have these delegates who were going to be elected, right? But then they couldn't elect them because there was a Supreme Court lawsuit that said they couldn't have an election. And basically, the decision makers at Kanaʻioluwalu said, okay, all you guys are going to be delegates then. Who like to be a delegate? Raise your hand. That's how it went. That's how the Constitution was made. Whoever like to be a delegate, you can be a delegate. And then, of course, these delegates went into the Kanaʻioluwalu meeting for that one whole month and planned out this Constitution. But in closing, I want to say that this is the interesting thing to me. Interesting, disturbing, sad, that despite all this information, all these layers of broken trust, of mismanagement, of irresponsibility, of unethical behavior, of lies, people still went and did it. The one thing I will say is the independence guys who went in, I think most of them were very clear, and I don't want to blame them, because the independence guys went in to see what was going to happen, yeah, so that we're not caught in the dark, and went in to continue to try to fight from inside that arm. But all the other guys who really believe in this as a nation-building process, they believe in this despite all of these lies and deceit and hell that I just told you. So at what point do we draw the line and say we're going to be principled, that we're going to do this right, we're going to be inclusive, we're going to practice these principles and not just talk about them. And that's why we're here today. Mahalo nui, aloha.
I want to mahalo Andre because the history that he just provided and the context and the analysis is really important, because we need that continuous analysis so that we can spread the education and awareness. We're not even at the point of needing to get to a constitutional document or ratification yet. For those of you who know, there were those that were arrested. Andre is one of them, and we want to have Andre just speak real briefly about that and recognize those that were arrested and kind of the thought process behind that before we bring up Auntie Lynn.
So, we got arrested at the gate, yeah, so they held were very strategic. They held the Kanaʻioluwalu Aha at the Maunawili Golf Course, which has a big gate at the bottom, and it's a 1 mile drive up into the golf course to get to the meeting house. So they made clear, they made sure that they were able to control access. And there was so much cops and security there. For we went to protest. We went to the declaration that Kalama read you, the declaration condemning and rejecting Kanaʻioluwalu. A handful of us drafted that, and it was for the purpose of creating a direct opposition to whatever documents they produced and a record of opposition. So we wanted to deliver that document to Kanaʻioluwalu as like a cease and desist order. And of course they didn't let us in. And so we entered into direct action, right? Direct action and activism is when you take it to the next level of sometimes breaking the law for principled reasons. So we blocked the gate. Said, you're not gonna let us in. You're using $3 million of our trust monies. You guys are talking about our future, my children's future, your children's future, our self-determination, and we're gonna block the gate. So we blocked the gate. And eventually we got arrested. But we got arrested really as a matter of principle, as a matter of civil disobedience. Ever say that there was no resistance to Kanaʻioluwalu. So that's what we got arrested for. And we got arrested for criminal trespassing, and eventually we just finished up court for most of us, and we got the case dismissed, trying to turn out of court, because the landowner never show up. So if you go charge somebody with trespassing, you gotta be there as a representative for the landowner. The guy never show up. However, we have two more friends, actually three, Kalama and Kalekoa Kaeo and Kahoko Kahi Kanuha from the Mauna Kea movement, who are still proceeding with their trial. And in particular, Kalekoa Kahoko Kahi are kind of hanging in there because they're using Ōlelo Hawaii in the courts. And they want to push that envelope of Ōlelo Hawaii. So to me, that's important. I'm going to close it out with this one Ōlelo no e ao. I grew up on a pig farm on Kauai in Hanapepe. And
It was the largest slop-fed pig farm on Hawaii. We had like 130 pigs at any given time, and we made emu every week. So I was trained in a very strict emu protocol. And the mantra of how we made emu was, Hana kalima kapuni, I have a kawaha. Yeah, so if you work with dirty hands, Hana kalima kapuni, I have a kawaha. You don't put Eva stuff in your mouth. And so I liken this to the Nā'iaʻopuni process, yeah? If you're going to work with pilau hands, the outcome will be pilau, yeah? It will be heaven, not going to be good, yeah? You cannot make filet mignon from, okay, you know, fat scraps. And so this has been the mantra for me, like, looking at this nation-building process. If it's not going to be pono from the beginning, the outcome will never be pono. Mahalo.
I wanted to take a look at, Audrey's doing some great, great things regarding Hanakihau Learning Farm. Look out for Facebook, also for movement for Aloha Āina. I want to bring up Auntie Lei, actually Uncle Liko, who's going to sing some mele for us, and then Auntie Lei, who's going to talk about our aha over here.
Audrey, don't forget your ribbon, huh? Okay. So I'm up here just to announce again that we have an aha over here, and it's symbolic of this gathering. An aha is a gathering, in this case, all those who are participating, listening, and this we have two cords. One is for the genealogy of families that come from Papakōlea, and they're in yellow, green and black for our family members that have gone on to the other side. And we wanted to get a record account, and just in the ribbons, as a symbolic representation of genealogy record. The other one is also is an aha as well. It's generally a gathering, a council, and a government assembly. And like we're doing today, Papakōlea has achieved one big thing, is getting a Papakōlea declaration from the processes we had earlier. So we're asking for you to also lend your time to the aha, because that aha, that cord is going to go with this Aloha Āina platform. It's a mobile platform, political platform. We don't want money. We have to pull out our own pockets to get things going, but you know, aha doesn't want to see any other process or paths to self-determination. So, you know, we're no more money, just, you know, lend your mana to the fact that this is a good Kanaka Maoli conscious raising event and that you're here in support. With that being said, so also, the black for the kupuna, we're looking at those who champion our causes. So I'm going to name a couple people who champion our causes in the political movement. And he's from Kalama Niheu, and he passed back in 1992. His name is Pujin Kavaipuna. You guys remember him? Kavaipuna. Gail. Okay. Yeah, he was like an Andre, actually, you know. He was all over the place. He's one of our own. We recently had a passing of another few me'es, and that was Puri Pau. So many of the political tapes that you folks seen and being educated about our movement, it was Puri Pau and his wife, Joan Lander, of Namako Kaina, and produced a lot of tapes for our learning about what happened in Hawaii. We had Kekuni Blaisdell, strong proponent of political independence and Hawaiian nationalism. And we also had from Makaha side, Leandra. What was her name? Leandra Y, right? Y. Also, one of the old-timers, his son is over here today, I don't know where he is right now, but Keonio Agard's father, Louis Agard, and he was another proponent in our struggle. So, if you folks remember names of Kupuna that stood on our side, maybe you would like to see them up on that aha on our court over there. So without further ado, another proponent of Hawaiian nationalism, my good friend, Liko Martin, is here to sing a song called The Patriots. Thank you.
So you know, I read songs, and I heard Don Ho's name earlier. Don Ho was the one who asked me to write a song, because I was going back to Honaunau and had come over to sail on a Papakōlea. And the song that I gave to him 4 hours later in his dressing room was "Aloha Āina Papakōlea." He was the first one to record that song. And last year I had a dream. Don was down in Waikiki. And Don came to me. It's typical, very disguised. You wouldn't be able to tell it was Don Ho. Cap, glasses, baggy pants. And he was very concerned because in Don Ho's time, he sang for the tourists. He supported the whole tourism thing, but he loved his Hawaiian people. And he was very concerned. And so I've lived with that dream over the last year. And the other week I was up on Kauai, and I was just about to pick up the Kue petition. And all of a sudden this song came to me. The words, everything, I had to run, get my guitar. And it talked about the Patriots. You know, Andre, everyone who's come before, anyone who, even those who, you know, are involved and we're using our group, portions of our group to do something without the consent of the other members, which is, you know, they're still Patriots. You have to be careful not to alienate themselves, because sometimes you get a little desperate, get set up, get in a box, figure why not. But really, we are still all one. So. Okay, so this song.
Patriots
held on me. And time went by, how it did fly. I hear the cries behind prison walls, they die. Sleeping on the sidewalks on the cardboard sheets with the Patriots we won. So when there's nowhere to run and there's nowhere you can hide, and the only thing you got is to give up your life, and you can't buy in and you can't live free, the only thing that's left is the Patriots' dream.
Yeehaw.
All right. Patriots were gathered at the palace steps. Some just watched and wept. Others simply fled as the Marines came marching up the boulevard with their Gatling guns and the shining swords. And the Queen looked down from her palace walls, standing tall for one and all. Her song of Aloha fills the air, but the Patriots live on. So the Patriots gather 40,000 strong, protest the taking of the sacred ground. And like a queen who left her letter on the justice door, the Patriots live on. And when there's nowhere to run and there's nowhere to hide, and the only thing you got is to give up your life, and when you can't buy in and you can't live free, the only thing that's left is the Patriots' dream.
Okay, okay.